I am Brother Matthew. Thank you for tuning in once again.
He will lift up Jesus ever.
Delivered by our General Superintendent, Pastor W.F. Kumoye.
Father, we do thank you for this day of worship. Thank you, Lord, because of your word that grants us wisdom unto salvation. We pray, Lord, you make every one of us wise as for our future in Jesus' name. Thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. It's a privilege to look at the word of God and to see what the Lord wants us to think about as for our future here on earth, our future in eternity too. We're looking at Hebrews chapter 11. I'm reading from verse 10. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 10. For he looked for a city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. It's good for us to think about our future. It's good for you to think about your future. And for me to think about my future. And to think about eternity. I think about that period when time will be no more. When you spent 1,000 years, another 1,000 years, 1,000,000 years, and 1,000,000,000,000 years, and you have just begun. And to think about the life that we now live, so brief and so short, that the Old Testament says it's like a dream of the night that comes and passes away. Another passage says it's like a weaver's shuttle that comes in and goes out almost without noticing. It says it's like a dream that is forgotten. But when you think about eternity, eternity is so long, it's so difficult to describe. If you will think about an ant that comes from your district and then goes very slowly, as the ants are apt to do, until gets to the place of worship here and then goes back again, how much time that will take? And that will be like just 1 second. When that ant has done that 1,000,000 times, 1,000,000,000,000 times, eternity has just begun. When you think about eternity, it's time without end. Eternity is the lifetime or the lifespan of the Almighty God. From all eternity, from everlasting, it's always been there. And until all eternity, till everlasting, it will still be there. Or think about a person just living and living and living and will never die again. That's eternity. That's why the Old Testament people, those of them that had revelation of the Lord, they thought about the things of the world, no doubt, but then that became insignificant as they thought about the eternal future. That's why it says, and you know, it's here talking about the people called the heroes of faith. It's talking about Abel and Enoch, and it's talking about Noah and Abraham. It's talking about Sarah and then Jacob and Isaac and Joseph. It's talking about all these patriarchs and all these men of old. It's talking about Moses and talking about Samson and talking about Gideon and Barak and the rest of them. And then it says, all these people, Abraham standing up very clearly in verse 10, for he looked for a city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. And that's the reason why they never troubled themselves. Whenever they missed anything on earth, you're thinking about Abraham and Lot. And Lot chose the well-watered place. And almost nothing good was left. And then God called Abraham and said, Abraham, come on here. and look at the stars of heaven, and look at the seashore too, and look at all the sand at the seashore, and look north and south and east and west. Everything you see, I've given it unto you. Even with that promise, it says in verse 10, he looked for a city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. He had the earthly promise of the land of Canaan. He had the earthly promise of the west and the east and the north and the south. But he said, I'm looking for something greater and something better. Then he says in verse 13, these all died in faith, not having received the promises. These all died in faith. Why wasn't their faith shaking? Because their faith was placed not in something earthly, not in something temporal, not in something like land or property or houses or whatever. Because their faith was placed in that future that they were looking for. This all died in faith, having received, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, and were persuaded of them, and embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. Strangers and pilgrims on the earth. That's why eternal things, everlasting things, and the future things, and the things that will never get out of existence, and the things that will always be, and the promises of the Lord that remains ever and ever, and that glory land, and that beautiful land of Beulah, and that paradise, that heaven, that was the important thing to them. That's the reason why they never bothered, they never worried, they were never anxious about the things of this world. Because just heaven, they said that was their goal. Look at verse 14, for they that say such things declare plainly that they seek a country. Even after they got some things in this world, they said, we're still seeking another country. And truly, if they had been mindful of that country from whence they came out, they might have had opportunity to have returned. But now they desire a better country. That is, what kind of country? Tell me again. Unheavenly. Unheavenly. You know, many people do not know that those Old Testament people, that they never held, never grieved the promise of the physical things on earth with a tight hand. Because those worthies of old, those faithful people of old, those patriarchs and people and prophets of old, they were looking for something better, something greater, something higher. That's why it says, they desire a better country, that is an heavenly, wherefore God is not ashamed to be called their God. For he has prepared for them a city. And that's what keeps our hope alive. That's what makes us to know that whatever we're having here on earth is nothing compared with that eternal city, that glorious land at heaven. Look at verse 39. And this all, having obtained a good report through faith, received not the promise. You thought it was Moses alone? But it's talking about all these people from the time of Abel, even to the time of the New Testament. It says, this all, they died, and they still kept their faith, and they had a good report. And then it says, they received not the promise, God having provided some better things for us, some better thing for us, that they without us should not be made how perfect. Have you noticed that the children of Israel are not, although they are searching on part of it now, there's no peace there. There's no contentment there. There's no satisfaction there. That's all earthly. And the glory of it fades away. And think of all the battles and all the wars that have been fought in that physical land of Canaan. And God opened the eyes of Moses. And he saw that these people are going to deviate from the Lord. In fact, the Lord told him to write a song. and teach all the children of Israel this song, because they're going to depart from me, and the land I'm going to give them, flowing with milk and honey, is going to turn to another thing. I'll make it dry. I make the heaven brass. I make their ground, I make it like dust. There'll be no rain, there'll be no fruit on the land. There'll be devastation. All those prophets spoke about that. Joel was talking about the land of Canaan. And he said, an enemy is going to come, an army is going to come. And before them, it will look like land of Eden. It will look like watered land with milk and honey. Behind them, when they have devastated everything, it will look like parched ground. There'll be no fruit there. They knew that. And they knew that that land of Canaan was temporary, but something permanent, something eternal that they were looking for. That's why it says their minds, their hearts, their faith was on that something future. And that's what the Lord is reminding us today. That's why I'm bringing this message to you. Believers, present privilege and future possession. Believers, present privilege and the future possession. You must keep a balance in the tension. That is the tension of wanting to have something now and yet understanding whatever we have now, everything will fade away in value, in worth. It will depreciate. There is an inheritance, a possession that is not going to depreciate. Whatever joys you have today, that's nothing to build your castle on. And whatever inheritance you have today, that's nothing to build your joy on. And whatever flattery, praise, honor of men you have today, that's nothing to build on. It's the future possession. We're going to talk about the believer's present privilege and a future possession. You think about Moses. And you think about, you know, many people, when they read about Moses, especially when they read about the fact that he was not able to get to the land of Canaan, they forget the rest of the good things about Moses. You find the name of Moses apart from the name of the Lord Jesus Christ in the Bible. No other name comes near the number of times when Moses is mentioned. In fact, as you go from Exodus when he was born until Malachi, the end of the Old Testament, you find Moses coming up and coming up and coming up again with a great heritage and a great inheritance. You come into Matthew, and before you finish reading Matthew, you are going to find Moses and Mark. Moses is there, and Luke, Moses is there, and John, Moses is there, Acts of the Apostles, Moses is there. You come to Revelation, you find the name of Moses again. No other name, not even Joshua, not Caleb, not David, no other name, not even Abraham, comes near the mention of the name as you find the name of Moses. And many people do not understand. We're talking about the future. And when you think about the future, and about the future that Moses has gotten into now, is a glorious privilege. And I pray that you will have that same glorious privilege in Jesus' name. I divide the message to three parts. Number one, the prayer for an earthly privilege unanswered. The prayer for an earthly privilege unanswered. Number two, the preservation of more excellent privileges unaffected. Preservation of more excellent privileges unaffected. Number three, a possessor of an eternal possession undenied. A possessor, that's Moses. He possessed that eternal inheritance, eternal heritage, eternal possession. He was not denied that. A possessor of an eternal possession undenied. Number one, the prayer for an earthly privilege unanswered. We're looking at Deuteronomy chapter 3. Deuteronomy chapter 3. And I'm reading from verse 23. Here's a prayer that Moses prayed. He wanted an earthly privilege, an earthly possession. He wanted to get to the land of Canaan, the physical one. Verse 23, and I besought the Lord at that time, saying, O Lord God, thou hast begun to show thy servant thy greatness and thy mighty hand. For what God is there in heaven or in earth that can do according to thy words and according to thy might? I pray thee, let me go over and see the good land that is beyond Jordan, let me go over and see it, that goodly mountain and Lebanon. But the Lord was wroth with me for your sakes. Moses reminded them, the Lord was wroth with, he was angry with me because of you, not because of me. Let me alone, I just go through without any hitch, without any hindrance. But you baby believers, Egypt was never out of your mind, and Canaan was not as precious to you either. But because of you, he was angry with me and would not hear me. He didn't answer that prayer. And the Lord said unto me, let it suffice thee. That's enough. Moses, don't talk about this again. Speak no more unto me. Tell me the rest of that sentence. Tell me again. Tell me well. Notice that. Only of this matter. Only of that matter. You must understand that. Every other thing, Moses could still talk to God. Every other request, Moses could still talk to God. Every other need, Moses could still talk to God. Every other prayer, every other intercession, Moses could still talk to God. Only of this matter. You know, there are people, when they read their Bibles, they don't understand the limited scope or the limited span of what the Lord was saying. You can talk about other things. You can talk about the future, about heaven, about glory, about all other privileges, about the future of the children, about revelation. Anything you want to, you want me to show you, what their destiny will be, what their future will be, about your ministry, and about how you can carry them on, that you can drop the word in their hand, that after you have gone, they will still continue with me. You can talk about all that. Only one thing, Moses, I don't want us to talk about, because that one I have decided. And you know that there are many people that look at a very limited thing, and this is not just Moses alone. You're going to find that in different parts of the Bible, that God says, David, don't talk about building a house for me. You can talk about any other thing. As for building a temple for me, building a house for me, don't talk about that. Any other thing, come on, talk, I'll answer you. And you're going to find about James and John. I want to be on this side, I want to be on that side in your kingdom. Don't talk about that. Talk about any other thing. But just that, don't talk about. And Paul the apostle said, I'll show you in the scripture, there was a kind of messenger of Satan buffeting me, and over and over. And then I went to the Lord, and God said, that's sufficient. My grace is sufficient for you. Don't talk about that. You see, these men of God, great men of God, there were things that the Lord said, just that, seal it up. Just that. Don't talk about that. All the other things, let's come in fellowship. Let's talk about this, and think about the future. This one is temporary. David, you want to build a temple? That's temporary. The God of heaven, even the heavens of heavens cannot contain him. What house are you going to build me? Push that aside. And then, James and John, you want to sit here and sit over there? Why do you want that? Don't talk about that. It's prepared for whoever that is prepared with. But John, if I will that